Welcome to Intel on AI, the podcast that connects leaders with listeners. My name is Heather McGuigan, and I am your host. Today's guest is David Ellison. David Ellison is the Chief Data Scientist and Director of AI Engineering for Lenovo ISG. Through Lenovo's US and European AI Discover Centers, he leads a team that uses cutting-edge AI techniques to deliver solutions for external customers, while internally supporting the overall AI strategy for the Worldwide Infrastructure Solutions Group. Before joining Lenovo, he ran an international scientific analysis and equipment company and worked as a data scientist for the US Postal Service. Previous to that, he received a PhD in biomedical engineering from Johns Hopkins University. He has numerous publications in top-tier journals, including two in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. David, welcome to Intel on AI.
Thank you. It's wonderful being here.
So we've got a series of questions. I'm going to launch right in if you're ready.
Absolutely.
You lead Lenovo's AI Discovery Center of Excellence, which has generated more than $1 billion in revenue. From your perspective, what's been the most important factor in turning AI investments into measurable business value?
Absolutely. Yes, I think it's important, the most important, to start with business outcomes in mind and not models. A lot of people have a lot of science experiments sitting out there. You've got to define the KPIs out there so that you know when you're generating revenue or having cost savings, you know the actual impact you're having on the business. That's key. The next part is to build infrastructure for scale. You want to not just do a POC project that runs on your local computer. You want to design it from the ground up for how infrastructure scales over time. And then, you know, drive trust and adoption through responsible AI. You want systems that are trustworthy and communicate with the user and protect their privacy. All those are essential to delivering business value.
Now, you've executed hundreds of AI POCs across industries. So what patterns have you noticed that separate the experiments that scale into enterprise-wide solutions from those that don't?
Sure. The first, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, is clear business alignment. You know, your POCs should be tightly linked to a measurable business outcome. The next part is integrating into existing workflows. Scalable solutions don't work in isolation. You know, they need to fit with ERP system, CRM, and other operational platforms and other workflows that employees already use. If they don't fit into the workflow, nobody's going to adopt your AI project. The next part is a strong data foundation. You need clean, governed data. A messy data situation, messy and dirty data is going to make POCs not work as well, and you make it so you can't scale your solutions. And then finally, executive sponsorship. We run into this problem many times where, you know, the engineer thinks it's interesting, the business leader thinks it's interesting, but then the executive says, why are we even doing this? So it's important to have that enterprise adoption and the executive sponsorship.
Lenovo's One Lenovo strategy unifies AI offerings across the company. How does that approach help customers think about AI adoption in a more holistic way?
Sure. It does a number of things for the customer. First, it simplifies customer decision-making. Because you're dealing with one provider that has, you know, mobile to the cloud covered. And when you're not segmenting, you're not working with interoperability, you're not working with problems with different vendors. You have one vendor that can do the whole thing. So that, like I kind of mentioned, that ensures interoperability and scalability, since we know all these components can work together. And that allows us to focus on business outcomes and not just products.
Now, a lot of executives still think that AI means GPUs. How do you explain the business case for CPU-based inferencing when you're talking to customers at the boardroom level?
Absolutely. Now, if you need to use the largest models at the highest speed, then, you know, there's really no getting around GPUs. But CPUs can be a very valuable alternative under the right circumstances. One is and this is a little tongue-in-cheek, if you're not marketing in the market for a nuclear power plant for your data center, these GPUs are extremely energy heavy, and CPUs are much more energy efficient and require much less energy to produce output. You know, if you have problems with the GPU pricing and even availability, and then also if you intend inference, if you're doing large language models, if you're doing anything that's below, say, 8 billion parameters, that's a smaller model or a small language model, then you are much better off going with a CPU.
So compute cost is always top of mind. What should decision makers understand about the cost differences between GPU and CPU deployments for AI?
Yeah, you got to look at total cost of ownership. And, you know, a GPU deployment is at least three times more expensive than a CPU only deployment, given the constraints of what it can reference and what it can inference on. GPUs are also more expensive to power. So we encourage businesses to buy what they need. For example, like a postal service worker doesn't need a Ferrari to deliver the mail. You need a fast, reliable storage car that can store a lot of mail. So those would be the key points for looking at the different capabilities of CPUs and GPUs.
Now, Intel has built advanced capabilities like AMX, AVX into its CPUs. Can you explain, without being too overly technical, how those innovations change the performance equation for AI inferencing?
Absolutely. AMX and AVX are simply accelerators for AI. Modern AI models are mostly built off of matrix multiplication and vector operations. AMX and AVX accelerate the matrix and vector operations respectively. So they're just accelerators, essentially software accelerators for your code. And what it does is it helps close the gap, the performance gap with GPUs, and lowers the cost and simplifies deployment. So it's overall a great tool that's easy to use and integrates with your existing development process.
I'm going to ask a little bit about OpenVINO now. Intel's OpenVINO toolkit makes it easier to deploy models on CPUs. What makes this toolkit appealing to enterprises that might not have large in-house AI engineering teams?
Absolutely. The first of it simplifies optimization. You know, OpenVINO automatically optimizes AI models for Intel hardware without requiring engineers to rewrite code. So it simplifies that optimization. It has broad model support. So depending on what your team has developed is using, and you know, TensorFlow, PyTorch, Onyx, you don't have to worry about compatibility or retraining models from scratch. And finally, there's low barrier to deployment. By making it easier to run inferences on CPUs that enterprises already own. OpenVINO reduces the need for specialized GPU talent or expensive hardware investments. So between simplifying optimization, broad model support, and lower barrier to deployment, it's a great tool.
Now, you've worked on some fascinating AI applications from logistics to live sports. Can you share an example where CPU-based inferencing surprised people with its speed or scalability?
Yes. In fact, we just learned that we can host a diffusion-based image generation model to create HD images in less than 10 seconds for optimized models, for optimized models on the CPU, which is very impressive. If you notice, when you're trying to generate online, these images can take a long time, but this is less than 10 seconds. We're working with a university to create pathology analysis on HIPAA-compliant CPU-only clusters. So, looking at some of the largest images that exist, other than satellite images, these are some of the largest images that exist, and you're processing it on HIPAA-compliant CPU clusters. We've also done stuff with NASCAR and low millisecond inference using Intel. And, even if you mentioned logistics with the U.S. Postal Service, when I was there, we did everything on CPUs, 7 billion packages, many scan events, trillions of records, all done on CPU.
Amazing. Now, one of your projects involved working with a major sports program to analyze gameplay. What can leaders in other industries learn from that kind of innovation?
Absolutely. One of the powers or superpowers of AI is to see patterns that humans miss. Sports analysts will show how AI can surface hidden dynamics in fast, complex environments, can look at all the plays that happened during the first half, and then have an analysis ready for the halftime. So those coach can talk to the people, their players. So they can see these patterns that humans don't have time or can miss. It turns data into strategy. You know, coaches use AI insights to refine plays in real time. Business leaders can use that same principle. And then it builds a culture of continuous improvement. You know, athletes are continually trying to review tapes and understand what they can do better. Well, that is definitely a mindset that we could take forward in the business world.
I have a cricket match on Monday, and I wouldn't mind having that technology available to me so that I can up my run rate a little more on the day. That would be great.
That would be great, yeah.
You mentioned NASCAR a little earlier. So NASCAR's Smart Pickbox is one of your standout projects. How does AI change the way organizations think about real-time decision under making pressure?
Sure. First, let me describe the project, because even though it got wide press coverage, I'm sure that not everyone's familiar with it. So in NASCAR, you want to put just enough fuel in the car to get to the next pit stop or get to the finish line. Any more, you're riding heavy and wasted time. Any less, and you don't get there. You're not allowed to have any fuel gauges or fuel meters in NASCAR. I don't know why, but that's just the rules. So the current state of the art is for someone to sit there and count one Mississippi, two Mississippi with the gas can and kind of guesstimate what goes in the car. So we put a camera overhead and measured the time and the angle at which the gas can is attached for and gave a precise measurement of the gas, allowing them to release the car early, pulling forward 2 to 4 pit stops, put 2 to 4 positions per pit stop, and resulting in a first place finish in Richmond. So that's the project. How it impacts real-time decision-making under pressure, you know, it moves things from gut feel to data-driven calls. You know, instead of the one Mississippi, you're doing it with data-driven insights. You can deliver value when milliseconds matter. You know, we cut it by, you know, up to 2 seconds pit stop, and, you know, every millisecond matters. And so the broader lessons for enterprise, you know, whether it's finance, healthcare, supply chain, is how leaders can operate with confidence under pressure using data-driven decisions.
From your work with logistic providers like USPS, what role do you see CPU inferencing playing in industries where scale and efficiency are everything?
Sure. Efficiency at massive scale. You know, logistic networks process billions of packages annually. And the CPU already sits in the data center or the edge devices. So running inference directly on the CPUs allows us to use existing infrastructure without always needing more expensive options. It's broad accessibility, you know, with toolkits like OpenVINO that we talked about. Models can be optimized to run efficiently on CPUs, meaning you don't need specialized equipment. And then, you know, the fast inferencing and the wide scalability with CPUs allows for real-time decision-making everywhere.
Now, with hundreds of proofs of concept under your belt, how do you help customers go from a super cool demo to true production deployment?
Absolutely. I've mentioned this a few times, but anchor to business value. You know, the first step is making sure it's tied to measurable business outcomes. You know, engineer for production early. You know, you don't want to do a POC that's completely disconnected from how you're going to have to put it into production. And then, you know, drive adoption and trust. You know, even the best technology, even the best POC doesn't matter if nobody uses it. So if you need to invest in training, change management, and responsible AI guardrails, so customers trust the solution, are willing to rely on it day to day.
Now, you mentioning trust, you're a strong advocate for responsible AI. How do you balance the push for faster, cheaper, more scalable AI with the need for ethical and trustworthy deployment?
So I do, again, like to anchor in business value. You know, responsible AI, if it saves you, you lose customers when you don't have trustworthy AI. You lose customers when you have privacy incidents. This is a responsible AI is an imperative and a business first imperative, you know, and it also diversity and inclusion expands your market to more customers. So there's a lot of business value that the responsible AI can drive if you're doing it right. If you're just using it to stop projects and to you know, nanny over projects is not going to work right. But if you're using it to drive business value, it can do real good. And then you got to embed the guardrails in the process. You don't want to just do responsible AI at the end and just, try and slap it on at the once the product's already been signed. You have to build from the ground up with responsible AI in practice. And then there's a balance between pragmatism and responsible AI practice. You can't go too far one way, let the lawyers take it and, you know, make 1,000 question queries on responsible AI, and you don't want it to be willy-nilly. So you need to balance that pragmatism in order to get something that supports innovation, but also supports responsible AI.
Now, if you had to give one piece of advice to C-suite leaders evaluating their AI infrastructure choices today, what would it be?
Sure. I think the one piece of advice is design for total cost of ownership, not just performance. They need to weigh the total cost of ownership, the power consumption, licensing, the talent availability, integration. And, you know, this is where Intel's approach often wins, by lowering the operational complexity and cost while still delivering the performance.
Looking forward, where do you see CPU-based AI inferencing making the biggest impact over the next 2 to 3 years?
Absolutely. So edge and distributed AI is definitely an area where it's going to make an impact. CPUs will shine at the edge. Where you don't have a GPU in your smartphone. Retail, healthcare, manufacturing sites can run inference locally on standard Intel CPUs, you know, keeping costs low and latency minimal. As things go to our phones, as things go to the edge, a CPU is going to shine with high volume, low latency inference. Cases like fraud detection or recommender engines or conversational AI, where throughput matters more than the extreme model size, where you have a small language model. That is where you can deliver some value. And, you know, our agent-based systems are all designed with the idea that you're going to use small language models, smaller models that are work together collaboratively to solve a problem. And then finally, the hybrid workloads in the data center. You know, companies, you're going to unify AI and IT workloads, the CPU's ability to be a general purpose compute engine, and while optimizing inference, you know, reduces complexity.
I want to thank you so much for coming on the show today. This was such a detailed and well-balanced conversation as we look at how we can make things bigger and also how do we keep things, really valuable and really, really centered on the businesses themselves. So thank you for coming on the show today.
Absolutely. It was my pleasure to be here.
For everybody watching, this was David Ellison. My name is Heather McGuigan, and I am your host. Thank you so much for watching Intel on AI. Bye.
Visit intel.com/AI to learn more.